William Rodriguez, a janitor at the World Trade Center, talks about what he saw in the basement that day and why he's skeptical of the 9/11 Commission report. Former New York City Mayor Rudy Giuliani and former Oklahoma City Mayor Ron Norick discuss how they dealt with the tragedies that happened on their watch. That's tonight on American Perspectives. Tuesday will be the 6th anniversary of the 9/11 attacks. A man who survived the attacks, William Rodriguez, talks about that day, what he experienced, and why he has doubts about the 9/11 Commission's version of it. Mr. Rodriguez spoke in Los Angeles, and this is about 2 hours.
We'd like to begin, but we don't have any sound. Looking for sound. Ah, there we go. Yay. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. I can't believe there's so many people here. Thank you, thank you, thank you. My name is Julia Jecker, and I am the producer and the publicist of tonight's event. Good Karma PR was started 2 years ago in order to promote the works of people trying to effect change. We hope to affect you tonight with our program. First off, let me thank our main sponsors, IDEPSCA, which is the Institute for Popular Education of Southern California. Are you guys here? Can you stand up? And KPFK. As of July 17th, 2007, just 1 month ago today, our current president enacted several executive orders that include language so broad as to encompass anyone who speaks out against their corporate and immoral war. What exactly has happened to our country when simply speaking out or asking questions can be considered an act of dissent? Well, let it be known, we will not be silenced. I would like the people who are listening or maybe watching to hear this. We are professionals, scholars, engineers, scientists, counselors, pilots, ex-military, journalists, writers, and many others from all walks of life. This 9/11 truth movement can be found in every major city in the United States and around the world. Simply put, we will not ignore the glaring anomalies of that fateful day, no matter how distressing or uncomfortable or unsafe it makes us feel as a nation. We will not stop asking questions about 9/11, and we will not drop the subject. We owe it to the victims and their families and the men and the women who are sick and dying to this very day because of 9/11. As we approach the 6th-year anniversary, we, the people, demand a new and truly independent investigation into the events of September 11th. I have the great pleasure of working with my partner, Christine Blasdale, who is the senior producer at KPFK Radio, powered by the people. Over the last few years, I've watched Christine desperately trying to make the most of precious airwaves that deliver critical information to the public. In an effort to get these uncomfortable questions concerning 9/11 out to the public, Christine has faced scrutiny and opposition both outside and inside the Los Angeles station. Please let me remind everyone here tonight, for the sake of the victims and the nation, that it is our responsibility as citizens of this country to find out what really happened on September 11th. The truth will not be silenced. Next, please welcome 9/11 truth activist and supporter, KPFK's own Christine Blasdale.
Thank you, Julia. And hello, everyone. I am Christine Blasdale, senior producer at KPFK Radio, heard at 90.7 FM Los Angeles, 98.7 FM to our dear friends in Santa Barbara, and globally at kpfk.org. Before we bring on our next special guest speaker, I'd like to tell you a little bit, if I may, about tonight's media sponsor, which is KPFK, something I know a lot about. For 48 years, this listener sponsor radio station has not only informed the public, but has built understanding across communities and among individuals, nations, and cultures. KPFK's unique brand of diverse views that's mixed with news, public affairs, arts, health, spirituality, has made it a precious part of Southern Californians' lives. Much like our speakers here tonight, KPFK promotes the creation of a better tomorrow via the full distribution of public information. For only a truly informed public can one day create a truly just world for us all to live in. KPFK stands for speaking truth to power, no matter who it may embarrass. Be it presidents or kings, CEOs, or the multinationals that they hide behind, KPFK has had a long history of making them all a bit uncomfortable. And we won't stop now. No matter how many of our emails are read, no matter how many of our phone calls are tapped, no matter how many times our internet activity is being monitored, no matter how many of our rights have been taken away, we will continue to push the envelope. We must push that envelope. In 1979, when American embassy personnel were being held hostage in Iran, KPFK and Roy of Hollywood were there to make a call into the embassy, and someone actually picked up the phone, making radio history. In 2004, when Haiti's President Aristide and his wife were being kidnapped and taken by force out of office, KPFK and Margaret Prescott went live with a report from the palace to make sure that the truth got out to you people. Unfortunately, if you follow that story all the way through, the U.S.-backed rebel leader Guy Philippe and his paramilitaries retook control of the Haitian army and police. Guy Philippe, by the way, was trained by the U.S. Special Forces in the 90s in Ecuador. And his personal heroes happened to be Chilean dictator Augusto Pinochet and Ronald Reagan. And more recently, after the death of over 500,000 Iraqi and Afghani citizens, 500,000, after Treasury Secretary Paul O'Neill admitted that the Bush administration began planning a war with Iraq long before 9/11, after discovering that prior to 9/11, a large amount of put options were placed on United and American Airlines, after Donald Rumsfeld announced on September 10th that the Pentagon somehow lost track of $2.3 trillion. Just don't know what happened to it, folks. It's It's magic. After hearing eyewitness testimony saying that people heard explosions going off in the WTC buildings before the planes even hit, and after people like you have demanded more discussion and more debate on that fateful day about September 11th, KPFK was there and is here tonight doing what major media should be doing, giving those who seek the truth a platform to speak. People like William Rodriguez, David Ray Griffin, Professor Stephen Jones. I've been able to bring just a few of these voices to the airwaves, but I need your help. Be it by purchasing their DVDs or their CDs, or by talking to them with other media outlets, not just KPFK, we need to educate others on the dangers of this global war of terror that is being unleashed in the name of those 3,000 plus people who perished on that day at the Trade Towers and at the Pentagon. And I'm here to tell you that one person really can make a difference. Just by starting to talk to strangers, you can see where you get. More people are waking up, but there's a few that are still asleep. Whatever step you take, whatever small step you take, it will make a difference. For $25 a year, you can become a listener supporter of KPFK, which makes you eligible to vote for the local station board, which helps guide policies and programming. And I can't tell you how important it is to have stand-up, stable people on the LSB. If you want to find out more, you can log on to kpfk.org and get involved locally. Okay, so now I've told you a little bit about the place that I call home. I'd like to now introduce our special guest speaker. He has consistently served and committed himself to both human and animal rights, world peace, environmental preservation, and political freedom. And while my partner Julie and I would really like to, we'd like to think that we were the first people that handed him his 9/11 video. We were all secret about it. Ed, you gotta see this video, it's gonna blow your mind. We are eternally grateful to him for his courage to stand up at this time, as well as his courage in speaking out against U.S. policy in Central America, which has for far too many years left millions of people devastated and natural resources devoured. He is perhaps best known as the gruff but soft-hearted journalist Lou Grant from the TV newsroom comedy The Mary Tyler Moore Show. He continued the role in the newspaper set drama Lou Grant, which won him oodles of Emmys and Golden Globe Awards. He's received several awards for the miniseries Rich Man, Poor Man, Roots as well, bringing his total, if you're counting, to 7 Emmy Awards and 5 Golden Globe Awards. And he was inducted into the TV Academy Hall of Fame and served as national president of the Screen Actors Guild. He was honored in 2002 by the Guild with the prestigious Life Achievement Award, which is given for career and humanitarian accomplishment presented annually to an actor who fosters the highest ideals of the profession. While you may know him best as Lou Grant, I personally can't help but think of him as the voice of God. It was a role he shared with Ellen Burstyn in the audio tape versions of Conversations with God. Probably you haven't heard it, but it's awesome. And I've got to say, Ed, if there really is a God out there, I hope he's a lot like you. Kind of scary at first, but then when you get to know him, you don't want to leave his side. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome a dear friend to KPFK and a dear friend of mine, Mr. Ed Asner.
Thank you. Thank you. And good evening to you all. I think it is typical to say that in any other country, Willie Rodriguez coming to speak, the sanctuary would be jammed to the rafters to hear this This man we can call a witness to truth. And the fact that America does not provide him with the rafter-clinging crowds is symptomatic of what our country is like these days. I came to understand the huge importance, and I don't know where it first originated, what great philosopher coined it, but I, of course, came aware of it during the Vietnam War with the marvelous bumper sticker, "Question Authority." And authority was partially questioned at that time, and it helped change the course of that war, the course of our government, and the people felt, in many respects, a greater strength than they had felt since World War II. There was divisiveness. The one chink in the armor was that we didn't respect our troops. So the enemy this time, to those who would deny this war, have come about with nothing but support the troops. If you don't support the troops, then you're a traitor. Well, I think most of us here would be very happy to support the troops by bringing them home. What greater support could we give than maintaining and sustaining human life in our troops? And so we must fight for that. We must fight for the symbol of the orange. And we must fight for the unbelievable ineffectuality of the American people in attempting to listen to the truth. An unbelievably shy people. I can't tell you the number of people I have been in the company of, scientists, learned gentlemen and ladies, and attempt to open, and I openly say I'm a conspiracy buff, at least as far as 9/11 goes. I believe in it fervently and with all my heart. And I said, if we have time, I will be glad to present the facts as I know them. And those facts have never been refuted. And if they have been refuted, the counter-arguments were never allowed to surface and be heard. And when I present these arguments to people I know and respect, whose intelligences I respect, they get that stare on their face. Oh, and sting music starts to play behind. Woo, 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 woo. Gotta get out of here. Here's another nutcase. No, it's emblematic of how blind our people are, to the extent that 50% still believe in creationism. Vast majority, we are so far behind the rest of the Western world in progressive attitudes towards life, the living, towards mankind. And that same blindness affects us on the truth for 9/11. And that's why I am so damn glad to be here tonight, to thank you all for coming to this important event, to rip the scales off your eyes and to hear yet another truth speaker named Willie Rodriguez. And the reason we've come together tonight is to pay tribute to this true hero. It's easy to label someone a hero. You know, Somebody's even had the gall to occasionally refer to me that way, and man, they don't know what the hell they're talking about. A person who rushes into a burning building or even rescues a cat from a tree is expressing their belief that something other than their own well-being is important and valid and worth saving. And that is a quality that is not only to be admired, but to be emulated. Oh. And how rarely does that emulation take place? But what about those people among us who take that extra step? Not only risking their own lives for others at a time of sheer panic and utter devastation, but doing it over and over again and then speaking truth to power, no matter how frightening, no matter where it leads us as a nation. We had a 9/11 Truth Commission that went through like a three-ring circus. I think most of them were hired to rake the elephant. And they did rake the elephant, particularly the GOP elephant. They raked that elephant good, to the extent that nobody, even if there was no criminality, there was not even a brownie, i.e., the New Orleans hurricane, there was no brownie who was dispatched in the tragedy that occurred on 9/11. That monumental level of incompetence that took this nation and allowed 3,000 people to die and eventually led us to war in two countries, and not one person has been disciplined, censured, fined, imprisoned for lack of competence. Now, on September 11th, the entire planet experienced a tragedy. The world was there to serve us. One of proportions and effects that undoubtedly changed us all in perpetuity. We were told it was 19 Arabs, not 18, not 20, but 19 Arabs with box cutters led by a man in a cave. Let's see, who was that, Methuselah? And we all believed what we were told. Besides, why would anyone lie about such a thing? As it turned out, of course, if we follow our research, a goodly proportion of those 19 Arabs identified by name were alive and living elsewhere. I never found out what the real names of the mistaken Arabs were, but the ones identified as such existed elsewhere, did not die in those crashes. It was also a day that many ordinary people in New York became extraordinary. One such extraordinary man is with us tonight. Under extreme pressure, not only did he put aside the natural reaction of fear, and how many of us know when and where we can do that? Something that can paralyze a person. But he embarked on a journey so massive, so life-changing, that it has expanded and changed the lives of people across the globe. Make no mistake, folks, this is a dangerous man to the Bush administration. His testimony, which was omitted from the 9/11 Commission, destroys the government's official story. And they know it. The corporate media also knows it. Thankfully, we have stations, radio stations like KPFK, Let's hear it. And find organizations like C-SPAN who are willing to let his voice be heard. When the simple act of telling the truth becomes a revolutionary act, then we are all in for a bumpy ride. And we should all be there to cushion that bumpy ride for the person who helped show us the route. But if we could strive to be half as brave, half as determined as tonight's speaker, and perhaps we could change the course of history the way he did on September 11th. A man of strength, man of hope, and the last man out of the World Trade Center. Please give a warm welcome to someone who exemplifies the word hero. Mr. William Rodriguez. Kick ass.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Wow. I feel like a coffee cake when they put the syrup on top. My goodness. I'm so glad, I'm so honored to be here. I'm so honored to be introduced by one of my heroes. It doesn't happen every day, really. And I grew up watching you. You're not that old. You're not that old.
You played Rossi, right?
No, actually, I play Ricky Ricardo. Do you understand my accent? Do I look like Ricky?
You have some explaining to do.
That's what I say to the White House. Well, number one, welcome. Welcome for being here. Can you hear me in the back? Can you hear me on the top? Thank you. Well, I want to say thank you to KPFK for the effort of putting this together. I want to say thank you to C-SPAN for having the guts to listen to the families of survivors and those affected by 9/11. I'm going to move to the front here. Let me just move a little to the front so we can lower the feedback. And they told me I have to stay within my boundaries. I usually, if you've seen the presentation before, I like to talk to the people, get close to the people, but because we have boundaries, I won't be able to do that. But anyway, my name is William Rodriguez. I am a person that before 9/11, I was a janitor on the towers. I worked in the building for 20 years. 20 years cleaning the stairwells of the North Tower. Now, have you ever cleaned 110 floors of stairwells? It's bad! It's really bad! It's not easy. Try doing 25 stairwells, 25 floors. It's really difficult. It's not easy. But that was my job. But incredible was that God really prepares you for things in life. And I'm telling you this because I was agnostic. I didn't believe in God. I didn't believe in anything before 9/11, honestly. I was like, oh, I'm spiritualistic. But in reality, was God was preparing me with tools for 20 years. The first 10 years at the World Trade Center, I cleaned the office of the then governor of New York, Mario Cuomo. And I have to be the person with somebody else that set up all the chairs on all the press conferences. And I have to set up the podium, put the water for the governor, and I have to stay there in case of any accident or anything that had to be cleaned. And then also I have to be the person that have to be on the legislation meetings at the office. And have you seen politics and legislations? Are really boring, really boring. But I have to be the person there that gave coffee, bagels, and donuts to the legislators. Now, I said that God has a very strange sense of humor. Huh. Because he was giving me the tools that I was going to use after 9/11. Because again, then I learned from the office how to set up a press conference, what a soundbite was, argumentation and debate, everything, because I lived through it for 10 years. And after 9/11, when I became an activist, I just used all those tools that were presented divinely by God to me. And that's what I did. So just goes to prepare you in different levels of life. Now, I'm going to put a slideshow. Let me just set it up for you here. And let me just go over here, if you give me a second. I just did a... we can, because we are actually filming for The Nation right now. So basically, well, I will take you through the slide. I just came from a tour through Europe. This is my fifth tour through Europe. I call this one the gravy tour, because there was a guy that started attacking me on the internet and attacking the victims and survivors of 9/11, that I sent the attack to everybody and every family member on my list, and they send it to other people. And then I started getting invitations from all over the world. So we turned a negative into a positive. Now, when we did that, we went all over UK for a month and a half, and we presented basically every single city. I saw more of the British country than the British people. That's Liverpool. I met somebody from Liverpool over here, Grange. Grange was very interesting, because the hotel that invited us over there put out a press release after they invited me that said that they were disinviting me, but they never sent that to me. They sent it to the newspaper. And it said 9/11 hero banned from hotel. And I said, what's going on here? So I called the newspaper and said, oh, it was put out by the hotel. But I didn't do anything. And I went with the presentation. And just to show you how you turn a negative into a positive, it was the biggest audience we ever had, because it was packed. So something wrong, you can turn it into something right. So you have to learn that about activism. And that's what happened with Grange. From there, there was other presentation, radio coverage from BBC on every city, television, meeting with George Galloway, who was a member of parliament. You know the situation with George Galloway was the one that was brought at the Senate hearing because of the Oil for Food program, and he basically embarrassed the senator. UK colleges, presentations in Paris. Now, this was in Malaysia last year. I went to Malaysia, and as you know, Malaysia is a Muslim country, Islamic. How many knew that? When I got invited, was to speak at the International Islamic Conference, and I get a phone call. Somebody saying that he was from the State Department. Mr. Rodriguez, don't go to Malaysia. I said, why not? They're gonna kill you there. Me, why? Because you are a survivor of 9/11, you represent the victims of 9/11, and they're Muslims. Well, they never told me that Malaysia was, number one of the biggest supporters of the United States. Number two, that it was a moderate country. Moderate country. You have Christians, you have Buddhists, you have every single religion over there. So I decided to go anywhere. I went there, and I must tell you, I feel so embarrassed to tell you this, because when I went to Malaysia, already predisposed by the negativity of going over there, I was treated with more love, more respect, more attention, and more dignity by those Muslim people over there than I did by my own government. Eye-opener. Eye-opener. You see, It was important to go over there because it was a historical event by itself, because here is the last survivor of the North Tower going to a Muslim country to talk about 9/11. The other community most affected because of the event. So they had a vested interest to listen to the families and survivors of 9/11. I met with the Prime Minister, former Prime Minister, Dr. Tun Mahathir Mohamad, the father of Malaysia. Nice man, who introduced me to Rafia here, who is the Chancellor to the United Nations, who introduced me to the Chancellor of Foreign Relations. From there, I met the Prime Minister, and so on and on and on. And all we asked was for a new investigation, an international inquiry about what happened on 9/11. Two countries were represented at the towers, and that situation makes it an international crime scene. Under the international law, when a country fails to do a thorough investigation, then the other country affected have the right to do their own inquiry. 6 years after 9/11, families, victims, and survivors are still searching for answers. We are still searching for answers. We have become the chess game, not only for the federal government, but by the state of New York. 6 years after 9/11, we have nothing on ground zero. There's nothing there. 6 years after 9/11, we're still asking the government to take the ash and remains of our loved ones that were placed on a garbage dump called Fresh Kills Landing in Staten Island, to be removed and be placed back on ground zero, because we don't want to pray for our loved ones on a garbage dump. Do you think that's okay? No. Do you want to pray to your loved ones on a garbage dump? Yeah. No, because ground zero was the lasting place, the last place of our loved ones. That's sacred ground for us. But it has been politicized so much. You know, I used to be the family advisory council for the Lower Manhattan Development Corporation. Check it out. And we knew how much they politicized the whole thing. It was all about the real estate, how to recover the real estate that was lost after the event. All we wanted the families was that on those 16 acres, that we only have 3.5 acres left, they place there a dignified, respectful memorial so we can go and show respect to our loved ones. They said, we're going to have it, we're going to have it. You know that the design has been changed continuously. The World Trade Center was built with no oversight by the federal, state, or the city, because the World Trade Center was owned by the Port Authority, an autonomous organization that did not have to abide by these rules and regulation, but they say that they surpass those codification. 6 years after 9/11, we're still dying. Why? When the collapse of the tower happened, the biggest toxic environment was released.
That's right.
Release. You have 160 almost first responders that went there to clean up the area, to look for the remains of our lost ones. They were exposed to the highest levels of carcinogens, PCBs, 116 different toxins. 160 of them from 10,000 that went there are dead. All the rescue dogs, dead. 62,000 people in New York sick, and they don't recognize it, for the simple reason that it would be the biggest liability case against the state. It was dollars and cents. Now we have people that don't have $100 a week to pay for their medicine, and they're still dying now. They have a death penalty. They have a death sentence on top of them. And it's immoral that 6 years after, we have not taken care of them. Just look at the pictures of the Pentagon and the pictures of the World Trade Center cleanup. On the Pentagon, you have everybody on hazmat protective gear from head to toe. Then look at the World Trade Center. They have dust masks, paper masks. They're not even good to spit on. And T-shirts. That's what you have. The EPA knew it was the highest levels of contamination ever recorded in history. But they wanted Wall Street to be reopened. We have the internal memo that basically talks about that. I did an interview with Dr. Doc Rocky, the father of the depleted uranium program for the military. And on video, he said that his unit is the first one that has to be called in a disaster, a national disaster, environmental disaster. And he called the EPA, and he was told to be quiet and to go away. And we have that on video. And this is the foremost expert. So 6 years after 9/11, we're still suffering. The nation is still suffering. We are an open wound that has not closed. We are in a process of healing that never comes. The families are still dealing with that process. The people affected are still dealing with that process as well. But the world has been affected directly because 9/11 has been the catalytic event that changed the history of the world in the new millennium. Anywhere I've been in the world, anywhere, they know about 9/11. Actually, they know more about 9/11 than we do over here. They're very concerned. 9/11 has been used as an excuse to basically eliminate civil rights everywhere. In the United States right now, you can be stopped and held against your will without the right to a lawyer indefinitely and without a court order. The spying program, remember the domestic spying program that they lied about it? Some whistleblower came out and said, oh, they're spying on the people here. Was a hearing, oh, no, it's only 6,000 people. And then we find out it was 3 million people. What about, now they have the order that they can open your emails, your mail, they can tap your phone without a court order. I mean, constant loss of our rights because of our tragedy. We do not agree to this international political agenda. We don't. On Malaysia, I spoke some of the meetings. That's the king of Malaysia. I met the king. Four press conferences. I will appear on every television news item. I will open the news at 8 o'clock every night. And they said at the end of the presentation, of the week that I spent there, that the Malay mindset about what happened on 9/11 and the issue of the victims will never be the same. It changed their mind forever because they didn't know about the victims' issues, because the information usually stays only in New York. Some people here don't even know what's going on over there with the victims. So from there, I went to Venezuela. And you know how Hugo Chavez loves the president. You met with the devil! You met with the devil! You see, I went to Venezuela because after 9/11, there were so many errors and mistakes because we were not prepared of an event of this magnitude. So we created something called the Blueprint to Avoid Future Emergency, Disaster Management. We wanted the world that showed so much compassion for us, the victims, to have this study so they will not commit the same mistakes. Things like who has to be the first responder, how you set up a family assistance center, what kind of technology you have to use in an emergency, how you distribute the funds. You remember the issue with the funds. $1.7 billion were collected for the victims. A non-for-profit organization were charging 70 cents per dollar on administration costs. Immoral? Yes. You know the scandal that happened with a red organization out there that the president quit because she wanted to create something called an Liberty Fund for the victims, and the board wanted to have a general fund so organizations all over the nation not related to 9/11 will go there and dip in and use it for computers, for pencils, for whatever. That was happening. I was a member of the board of directors of the 9/11 United Services Group, which was a coalition of non-for-profit organizations that was created to help the victims. So I have an internal view of what was going on and the problems. So we wanted to give this to other countries so they would not have the same problem. But of course, while I was in Venezuela, and I speak Spanish very well, say hello to my little friend. I was in Venezuela talking about this, but at the same time talking about my experience on 9/11 and the issues with the commission. And something strange happened. I get called by the director of the hotel where I was staying. Mr. Rodriguez, come to the front. Okay, I went to the front. He said, yeah, can I help you? Mr. Rodriguez, the reason that we have called you here is because something very strange happened. I said, what? He said, somebody came here and requested the list of all the guests staying in the hotel. And what does that have to do with me? And he said, because the person that came here identified himself as an FBI agent. He showed a badge. I said, what did you do? He said, oh, we kick him out because they have no jurisdiction. But you see, I got scared because I said, what's going on? If they wanted something, they could have called me. I mean, what's the problem? But I got scared. And I said, what does that have to do with me again? And he said, you're the only guest staying in the hotel. This is in the middle of the beach, all right? I'm the only one with a suit. Everybody was in shorts and sandals going to the beach. He said, you're the only one doing interviews on television, radio, and newspaper. So we know it's related to you. So I got scared, and I did what I thought it was right at that moment. I went on the following interview within an hour or so after, and I said the whole story with the hotel. Then I get a phone call at the hotel, very strange, a phone call from the palace. And getting a call from the palace is like getting a call from the White House. So, Mr. Rodriguez, we would like to invite you to the palace. Okay. All right. Now I'm scared. Let me go. And I said yes, and I went to the palace in Caracas. And I went to the palace, and I was given this beautiful tour. And incredibly, that the person that received me was Dr. Nicolás Maduro. He was at that time the president of the National Assembly. He's the most powerful man in Venezuela after Hugo Chavez. He's now the Chancellor of Foreign Relations for Venezuela. He's the one that was stopped at the airport here at the United Nations last year. And he said, Mr. Rodriguez, come into my office. And I was like, uh-oh, okay. And he goes, tells me, sit down. And you know when they tell you to sit down in a government office on another country, you're looking for the cameras. I was like, oh my God, what's going on here? And he said, Mr. Rodriguez, the reason that we have called you here is number one, we believe you. We know you're telling the truth. Number two, we check you out because we have our own intelligence. Number three, we know that that person that you talked about, the FBI agent, we identify him because we know who comes into our country and who leaves our country. And I'm like, okay. I'm getting nervous now. I say, oh my God, what's going on? I say, Mr. Rodriguez, we're gonna do something for you. I said, what would you do? And he said, we are going to give you protection. Now, I got very scared. He said, protection, why? He said, because we believe that your own country will do a hit on you on Venezuelan soil, blame it on us, and come over here and do whatever they want. And I got scared. And they gave me 5 bodyguards while I was in Venezuela, 5 bodyguards to protect me. This is scary. It's very scary. But the thing is that while I was there, and we're putting a video together of all those experiences, it was something like the movies, like, you know, a comedy movie. Because if I have to go to the bathroom, two guys will stand at the door, two guys will go in, get everybody out, everybody go. So I could go to the bathroom. It was crazy. Scary, scary, scary. But you see, it gave me a crash course on something that I never understood, which was false flag terrorism. When a country do something against somebody, blaming it to somebody else so they can do whatever they want. And I was like, whoa, 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 what am I doing? What am I getting into? From there, I went to Chile. Chile have 9/11 also, because 9/11 symbolizes nationally the day that Pinochet took over from Salvador Allende. So they thought that something was going to happen to me over there as well, and they gave me two generals to go with me everywhere. So I'm like, what the hell? I'm just a janitor. I was like, my goodness. So also we put in the video together with that. So we have so much from the last 6 years that we are trying to bring to the world. So as you know, and let me show you this part, that I started coming out with benefits and legislations for the victims, because there was a situation that the politicians were not getting close to the victims because they didn't want to be accused of using 9/11 for political purposes. So they left us alone. So we start working on those things. They passed. This is when we did the scholarship program for victims of terrorism. It passed. It gave education, free education, up to the age of 21 to any of the orphans of 9/11. $35 million were allotted by the legislature and Governor Pataki. Then we did one in Spanish. In other words, not in Spanish, but for the Latino community, because as you know, from a $1.7 billion that were collected for the victims, less than 2% went to the Latino immigrants that were affected by the event in the towers. So it was like a total disproportion. And from there, when we saw that the victims of the Windows of the World, which was the restaurant that was located on the top of the building, mostly immigrants, the families were not getting any help because the program, the federal compensation program, and all that stuff, FEMA is federal, it's only for citizens, they were not taking care of these victims that were basically killed like everybody else. So I went to every non-for-profit immigrant group and I asked them for help. And you know what? They closed the door on me. They said, don't lose your time. You're never gonna get it. I've been fighting for this for so long. Nothing. There was a federal compensation program created. The president designated Mr. Kenneth Feinberg as the administrator of this program, and I will show up on every press conference that he made, and every time he said, well, any question, I was like, huh? What about the immigrants? What about the people without papers that died in the building? Oh, you cannot help them. You cannot recognize them. They're non-existent. Can you identify them? That's the problem. Every press conference. So he got angry at me at the last one. He said, you, Mr. Rodriguez, if you identify those people, I will help you. I said, ah! And I went to Telemundo, and I went to Univision, and I said, I need a television commercial. And I did a television commercial, I identified all the people, went to Congress, spoke to him, and said, you have to deliver now. And within 90 days, we had the amnesty to help these people. But then I learned something. They told me that this group that supposedly helped the immigrants, were not gonna help me anyway because that's their business. Think about it. You go to a office, oh, I need help. They charge you for the papers. They charge you for the process. So if they get an amnesty, the whole system of their business will fall apart. So you have to be careful who you work for. So, all these things is happening after 9/11. I became an activist without knowing that I was doing it because there was so much trouble. Then you have the situation with the IRS. You know, the IRS was shaking up victims. People were coming over and saying, you know, the IRS called me and said that I have to pay the taxes of my husband that just died. He was the earner of the household. How am I going to pay this money? And a call to the IRS said, number one, that it was none of my business. And number two, that did I ever heard that the only sure thing in life was death and taxes? So we press, we work. We call Hillary Clinton, Senator Clinton. We call other people, and we have something called the Tax Relief Act for victims of terrorism, which actually erased the taxes of any victim after 9/11, any act of terrorism. For 2 years, they don't have to pay taxes. And it was also passed in record time. So, now, I become the image of 9/11 for the Latino community. I appear on programs that you may not even know, but they're more powerful than Oprah. Oprah gets 35 million viewers a day, but I was appearing on Cristina. Cristina is 102 million people at a show. I was appearing in Primer Impacto, Aquí Ahora, El Rojo Vivo, programs that have more viewership because they go into so many Latin countries. And I became the image for the community on everything related to 9/11. So, of course, by default, I was asking questions because they took me from there. Let me show you. Oh, they call this photo opportunity. I call it photo abuse. This is the investigation request that we did with the then Attorney General of New York, Eliot Spitzer. He said it should have been done on a federal level. Media expert on 9/11 for several newspapers in English and in Spanish. Don't shoot me! Don't shoot me! Don't shoot me! Don't shoot me! But now comes to the part that I want you to understand. What I just did now is the part that I hate the most, because I'm talking about, I did this, I did that, I. You know why? I'm gonna tell you why. When they saw that I was doing all of these, they said, this is the guy that we need to run for political office because he can get the Latino Hispanic vote. We're talking about 30 million voters nationwide. The community loves him. He's a hero, he saved hundreds of people, and at the same time, have no training and making changes in the community, we want him to run. So they told me to go and get training. And I said, okay, I just lost my job. And I took the training. And the first thing that you learn is what I'm doing right now, which I hate, but I wanted to take you by the hand so you will understand why am I doing this. The first thing that they teach you is that as a politician, you have to tell the community what you have done so you will understand what I represent on that community. And that's the first thing that I learned. When you see a politician on television, you say, oh, I work on legislation 1507, you always see the same thing. This is all political training. Did I run? Absolutely not. Did I want it to run? Maybe. Maybe, because I thought I could have done more for the community at that time. Sadly, that's when we started asking questions about 9/11. We wanted to have a formal investigation about what happened on the event. As you may remember, the administration did not want a formal inquiry about what happened on that day. They did not want it. They called the victims to give support to the president. They didn't want this. Think about this. They said, we don't need an investigation. We know who did it. It was the Muslims. Now, ladies and gentlemen, anywhere in the world, if you lose a loved one in a catastrophe like that, do not allow any government, any institution to tell you, you don't have the right to an inquiry. Always execute that right. Always do that. They didn't want it. We press, we put every family member that we could on every television show, And guess what? They got fed up with us. They said, okay, we're going to do it. Because it was so much publicity. They said, okay, we're going to do it. But we want somebody to represent the administration on that commission. And we said, okay, no problem. Who will that be? And they said, Henry Kissinger. For those who don't know, Henry Kissinger is considered a war criminal in many countries. And this was sending the wrong message to the nation and to the world that showed so much compassion for the victims. So we didn't want that. And they said, it's not for the family to decide. You have no option in here. That's what we want. Somebody, a pro bono lawyer, gave us the information. Check his client list. No, number one, have you ever heard Henry Kissinger speak? Yeah. Now, if you have problem understanding my accent, try understanding Mr. Kissinger. And I hate to make fun of people, but in reality, I could not understand the man. Family members have a meeting with him, and the family group is just trying to get his client list and other issues, and he didn't want to give us anything. And the reason we wanted that was because we knew he had clients from Iraq, Iran, Saudi Arabia, Yemen, all those countries that were claimed by the administration to be sponsors of terrorism. And that made it a conflict of interest. When the families decided that they were going to have a press conference, Mr. Kissinger had a preempting press conference, which was, I am removing myself from the 9/11 commission because I'm too busy. Tell that to the families. Tell that to the families. Families have been vilified. The Jersey girls have been called witches and money-hungry women, because they have been pressing for information, truth, the papers that were collected by the 9/11 Commission, all of that, and they are vilified by the far right because they don't want this information to come out. They don't want it. So, of course, here we are. We press, we get the 9/11 Commission approved, but at that time, remember that the president, how many people remember that President Bush, wanted to have a connection between Saddam Hussein and Osama bin Laden? Yes. You remember that? Yeah. He wanted to say that they were connected on 9/11, that they did 9/11 together. It was Hans Blitz, the inspector of weapons of mass destruction there, that came out and said, no, there's no connection. Remember Mr. Richard Clark, who was the czar of intelligence for the administration, who came out and said, they wanted me to make the connection, and I know there's no connection. And on the 9/11 Commission hearings, he said, they lied to the families. Well, actually, they failed the families on 9/11. So here you have that they're using our disaster, our despair, to do an invasion on Iraq. So we work and we organize a march against the war. And I was highly criticized because I started the march with soldiers. How dare you, Mr. Rodriguez, using our finest people to start a march against the war with soldiers? How dare you? Actually, we expected 10,000 people and we have the biggest march ever in history. We have 225,000 people marching against the war. Of course, what you have here is that I get embarrassed. I have a sachet that says, stop the war, stop the invasion. I get embarrassed because I have soldiers. And I said, okay, I'm sorry. I am so sorry. I'm not going to do it again. I promise you, I'm not going to do it again. But I must tell you that next week, I'm doing another march, but I will not use soldiers. And I did organize another march. And guess what? We got attacked again because this time I use officers. Who make them happy. You cannot make them happy. But when you're morally right, you've got to continue doing what is morally right.